Joshua was a soldier by the anointing. We will fight for territory. We will fight for space.
Now, it's time to buy the field in media, education, economy, in family, ministry, arts, and entertainment. Welcome to 2024, the year to occupy, heralding.
This is a success story. Our vision of all men celebrating endless life in Christ. How we effectively evangelize, make disciples of, and deploy a people who once upon a time were mere seekers, but are now mature disciples and vibrant ministers of the gospel, who live their lives for Him and His will alone, with Christ burning in their hearts and the gospel widespread in their lips, reaching a billion souls in 10,000 cities, souls who see through the lens of Christ and His finished work, who labor in the word and travail in prayer. This is our delight.
Good morning, church. I'd like us to stand up to our feet if we're excited to see the first month, the first Sunday in the month of April. I want you to jump up and just praise God. Glory to God. You don't seem excited. Glory to God. Welcome to Sunday service. This is Celebration Church, that church you heard about. And we're going to be taking our opening prayer from Acts chapter 20 and verse 32. I'd like us to open our Bibles to Acts chapter 20 and verse 32. And it says, "And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all of them which are sanctified." Glory to God. I want you to believe that there is transformative power in the word of God to strengthen you and to build you up in all that God wants you to be. And so I would like you all to repeat after me and say, "In this service," I can't hear you, "in this service, the word of God builds me up. I am rooted and grounded in the faith. Take that again. Say, I am rooted and grounded in the faith, and Christ is fully formed in me. I want you to turn that into a prayer this morning and declare that Christ is fully formed in you on account of today's service. Don't stare at me. Pray in the language of the Spirit and pray in your own understanding. Father, we declare in the name of Jesus that on account of the teaching of today in this service, that Christ is fully formed in us, that we are rooted and grounded in the word of your grace that is able to build us up, and that has given us an inheritance because we are among them that are sanctified. We declare in the name of Jesus that we are rooted in the word. As we receive the word of your grace this morning, that our spirits are built up. We increase in the knowledge of God. We increase in the knowledge of God. We are rooted in our understanding of the word of God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we are built up on account of the word of God that is taught in this service. Father, in the name of Jesus, your transformative work is done in us on account of the words that we receive. I want you to set your expectations this morning in the place of prayer and declare that you are built up in the word, that Christ is fully formed in you. Christ is fully formed in me on account of this service. In the name of Jesus, that you will bear fruit upward and your roots will go down in Christ Jesus. On account of today's service, the word of God transforms you. The word of God builds you up in your knowledge of God and in character. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I am transformed by the word of God, and Christ is fully formed in me. Christ is fully formed in me. In the name of Jesus, I am built up in the word. I am built up in my understanding. I am built up in spiritual understanding. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying. We're going to take our confessions this morning. Are you ready? Say with me, I approve the will of God for my life in this service. I am fervent in prayer. I am sold out in worship. I am attentive to the word. I am prepared by prophecy to be all that God has called me to be. Holy Spirit, I am ready for all you have for me. My mind is renewed. My heart is open. My life is forever changed. If your life is forever changed, I want you to rejoice.
Put those hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. We don't sound excited. Come on, put those hands together for Jesus. Let me hear you. We can do better. We can do better. We can do better. For Jesus. For Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey. Come on, turn to your friend. Turn to your friend and say, I am a friend of God. Turn to the other person and say, I'm a friend of God. Come on, do you believe that? Do you believe that? Let's go together. Hey, I am a friend of God. Yeah. All right, let's go.
So who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you live? love me. It's amazing. Who am I, Lord?
You are my love.
Come on, let's go together, sing it.
That you hear me
when I call.
Is it true, oh Lord?
Is it true that you were thinking of me?
Hey, how you love me.
How you love me.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God. He loves me,
great. Hey, yeah, yeah.
Come on, let's go together. Who am I? Hey.
Who am I that you are mindful of me?
That you hear me. No, wait, no, wait.
When I
go, hey. Is it true? Is it true? Is it true?
Is it true that you are thinking of me?
Come on. How are you?
How you love me.
We're gonna do that again. We're gonna do that again.
It's amazing.
Who am I? Who am I? Let's go.
Who am I that you are mindful of me?
Come on. That you hear me?
When I call, hey, is it true, oh God?
How you love me?
Let's go.
It's amazing. So amazing. It's amazing.
Come on, let's go.
Three more times,
let's go.
God Almighty.
the voices. I am a friend of God.
I am a friend of God.
I'm a friend of God. Hey.
I am a friend of God.
I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. You all sound so beautiful. One more time, one more time. I am a friend of God.
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 I am a friend of God. Together, let's go.
Just lift your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, because nothing can separate us from the love of God. Lord, we have come to testify. We acknowledge that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Someone, you just say thank you, Jesus, once again. Say thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Say it and mean it. Say thank you, Jesus. You know it. Let's sing it together.
Who am I that the highest would welcome? I was lost, but he brought me in his love. The sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
Say,
free at last, he has ransomed.
While I was a slave to sin,
Jesus died. Yes, he died for me. Say, oh, the sun is free. I am a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house. child of God. The sun sets free. Ooh, the sun
sets free. Oh, it's lifted. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
In my Father's house, there is a place for.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to Jesus. Oh, we have been rescued from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son, Jesus. We have been redeemed, and our response is glory. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we have worshiped. Glory to God. We'll be praying this morning. And I want us to open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 15 and verse 13. Matthew chapter 15 and verse 13. The Bible says, "But he answered and said, every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted." We see Jesus here speaking about, you know, the doctrines of the Pharisees. And he says that every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Every doctrine that was planted not by our heavenly Father will be uprooted. In this month, we'll be emphasizing, you know, orthodoxy of the faith. And that simply means, you know, the singleness of belief. And as Christians, if we claim that the Bible is the final authority, we must believe the same thing. If we believe that the Bible is the final authority, we must all come to believe the same thing. Glory to Jesus. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11 to 13 tells us about how God gave us apostles, preachers, pastors, teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry until we come to the unity of the faith. Until we come to the unity of the faith. Until we come to the unanimous belief of the faith. Glory to God. And I want us to pray with this understanding, because we cannot be children, you know, tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. We must be grounded, especially this month. We must be grounded in the word of God. And I want us to pray and declare this word with me. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare that every tree in the body of Christ that our heavenly Father has not planted is uprooted in the name of Jesus. Every ministry who teaches the true gospel of Christ is amplified. Come on, turn that into a prayer right now. He said, every plant that our heavenly Father has not planted is uprooted in the name of Jesus. Every doctrine that our heavenly Father has not planted is uprooted in the name of Jesus. We see the doctrine of Christ, the true gospel of Christ. Oh, we see it, oh, prevail in our time and in our day. Makapali brasum tole parandes. Every plant that our Father has not planted, we uproot it in the name of Jesus. Every plant that our Heavenly Father has not planted in our minds, every doctrine in our minds, ideologies in our minds that is contrary to the knowledge of God is uprooted right now, all through this month, as we learn, as we understand your word. Oh, Father, it does us good. It does a work in our heart. It brings down imagination. It brings down every thought that tries to exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Every doctrine that our Father has not planted is uprooted. Everything that I hold so dearly that is contrary to the word of God is uprooted in the name of Jesus. Oh, pray right now. I don't see you praying. Every doctrine, every thought, every imagination that is not of God, we uproot it right now in the name of Jesus. All through this month, as the word of God is taught, it comes on a heart that is ready and prepared, and that is ready and prepared to receive. And we speak over every ministry that is teaching the true gospel. We speak over every ministry that is teaching the true gospel. We pray that in the name of Jesus, it is amplified. Their influence grows. Oh, in the name of Jesus, men troop into their congregation to hear the true gospel of Christ. In
this. Rebebele brashane. Oh, rantali kepea. Oh, the gospel of Christ prevails. The gospel of Christ prevails in this city. The gospel of Christ prevails. We pull down every falsehood in the name of Jesus. We pull down every falsehood in the name of Jesus. Masuko polo brosutolianes. Rebebele brasantaliante. Oh, rantoli brande kapalia. Oh, thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we're still praying. In Jesus' name, we're still praying. 3 John chapter 1 and verse 2. 3 John chapter 1 and verse 2. I read in the King James Version. The Bible says, Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Wish above all things that thou may prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. As Christians, we must come to understand. We must come to understand that God loves us. We must come to understand that God cares about every aspect of our lives, even down to the things that we might call trivial. God cares. You know, I'm reminded in scripture, Matthew chapter 6, Jesus speaking, and he talks about how the birds of the air are being fed by him. The lilies of the fields are being dressed by him. In chapter 10, he tells us about how we are even worth more than many sparrows. Glory to God. Glory to God. So God cares about the nitty-gritty, every aspect of our lives. And with this understanding, I want us to come boldly, because he says that he wishes above all things that we might prosper and be in health, even as our soul prospers. So I want us to pray and say, Father, we declare that every member of CCI Global prospers. Our lives are testimonies of supernatural increase, divine health in career, in ministry, in relationships, and in business. We prosper in the will of God. Come and turn that into prayer. He wishes above all things that we might prosper and be in health. The same God that laid down his life for you, he cares about you. He cares about every aspect of your life. He cares about every aspect of your life. Are you not more worth than 1,000 sparrows? Are you not worth more than many sparrows? The Lord cares about you. Oh, he wishes above. Oh, about that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. Oh, we prosper in our health. We prosper in the works of our hands. In our careers, we prosper. In everything that we put our hands to do, it multiplies. In the name of Jesus. Likapana prasuto la prosite. Manteli kampanda liasande. Oh, our health is renewed. Our health is stronger. We do not grow weary in health. Masintele kokotolia pranduz. Ritelendos ikambania. Oh, ranteli prasunto. Every member of CCI prospers. Manko sikandele ambarunes. Ritele parantea. Our testimonies of supernatural increase. Oh, are multiplied towards us. Masintele baliandosa. Oh, we prosper in health. We prosper in career. Oh, rantalia barantea. All around us. Our family. In the name of Jesus. Our children. Our loved ones. They prosper and they are in good health. They prosper and they are in good health. In the name of Jesus. Those that are having failed health, we pray a restoration. Right now in the name of Jesus. Those that are having failed health, we pray a restoration. In the name of Jesus. Those that are having a failing in their finances, we pray for a restoration. The Lord said that I will restore what the cankerworm has eaten. Oh, in the name of Jesus, there's a restoration of finances. There's a restoration of health. In the name of Jesus, there's a restoration of careers. In the name of Jesus. Maka palabra sutoloposia. Rikaketeneli katalia. Oh, rantolabroside. Likantalia sutonolabros. Thank you, Jesus. We see a restoration. Matuzi Kambalianis. Thank you, Father.
In Jesus' name we have prayed. Glory to God. We'll be taking our confessions this morning, and I want us to always picture when God brought the animals to Adam, and as he gave them a name, that was the name. So as we declare these confessions, I want you to know that as you speak it, that is what it is. Glory to God. So I want us to declare with boldness and with gusto and say that in this month and beyond, my eyes are open to see the revelation of Jesus. The same spirit that was in Jesus dwells in me. Therefore, I do the works of Jesus. I bear fruits of the Spirit, and I manifest the gifts of the Spirit. As He is, so I am in this world. I mirror the integrity of Jesus in devotion, in doctrine, and in dunamis. I declare that I am full of power. People see it and discern it. It is communicable. It is transferable. I carry something contagious. It is the fire of the Holy Ghost. I prosper in the will of God. And I have limitless ability. These hands do the impossible. These hands never lack. Men are coming from afar to favor me, and they come bearing gifts. I declare that the truth of God's word prevails through me and my local church. Every tree that my heavenly Father has not planted is rooted out. Ministries that teach the truth are amplified, and disciples obedient to the faith are raised. We establish policies of righteousness and propagate the influence of the gospel. Celebration Church is marked by signs and wonders. We are a studious church, a praying church, an evangelical church. The impact of Celebration Church will shake the nooks and crannies of this world. We are 10 times better, stronger, faster, by the power of the Holy Ghost. Come on, rejoice with that knowledge. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus.
If you believe that we are 10 times better and stronger, I want you to leave where you are and rejoice. Glory! Hallelujah. Amen. Please have your seats. I want you to turn to somebody beside you and welcome them to service. Say, welcome to service. It's good to see you. I hope your day and your week was good. I hope you had a restful weekend. All right. Welcome everyone to service this morning. On behalf of our lead pastor, Apostle Emmanuel Aaron, and our resident pastor, Pastor Bright, I want to say big welcome to you. Please turn again to somebody, because we get a lot of first timers and I want them to feel your welcome. So turn to them. If you are sitting beside somebody that you know already, move away from your seat and greet somebody else and say, welcome. Ask them for their names. How are you doing? And if you're online watching as well, greet somebody beside you. Don't just observe, participate as though you are in service this morning. All right. Welcome everyone to service. If this is your first time with us, maybe you're in person or you're online at any of our cell churches and C churches, I want to say welcome to you. You are in the best place that you can be on a Sunday morning. I know our Hamilton Church is streaming online. Ooh, make some noise. Let them hear you. Awesome. And to all of our other locations all across London, Calgary, Winnipeg, Montreal, Kamloops, the Lord has been good, isn't it? Awesome. So welcome. Please make sure you participate as though you were in service with us this morning. Now to our key announcements. Our membership class will be starting this Sunday at 6 p.m. So if you haven't registered and you like to serve at Celebration Church or you like to be a member, please register. The deadline is 3 p.m. EST today. A lot of our teams are looking for more
hands that can serve in different capacities. So please, if you'd love to be a part of the work that God is doing here, you'd love to serve, you'd love to be a member, make sure you sign up for membership class today. Also, Deepa is around the corner. Glory to God. I don't know about you guys, but I've been writing my expectations, and the A4 paper is about to, it's not containing it anymore. So Deepa Canada is happening on May 17th to May 18th. Make sure you set your expectations. See, don't come on the 10th, or sorry, don't wait till the 10th, a week before. You're not like, oh, what do I want God to do for me at Deepa? Is that going to be anybody here in this room? So start setting your expectations. We have been praying as a church at 6:30 a.m. EST and 9:30 p.m. EST to prepare our hearts and to prepare our minds, because the revival that we have been praying for, we are going to see it happen right before our eyes. Does anyone believe that? Yes. So please set your alarm, set your calendar at 272 Atwell Drive, Toronto. 272 Atwell Drive, Toronto. Also, invite somebody. The Lord has been blessing you in Celebration Church. This is not a time to hoard it. Make sure you invite somebody to come as well. And our final announcement as our worship team comes up. Our interest group has kicked off. I heard that the creative group met last on Saturday, yesterday. The culinary group as well met yesterday. So please, if you'd love to join an interest group, this is a wonderful opportunity for you to build community, a wonderful opportunity for you to invite a friend that is maybe not a Christian and looking for community. So make sure you invite them to an interest group. If you'd like to sign up for one, you can come to the info desk or scan the QR code at the back.
Hallelujah! Can we rise to our feet as we worship Jesus and thank Him for who He is? Glory to God. Glory to God. Somebody say with me, I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. My salvation cannot be undone. My salvation cannot be undone. Shout glory! Just put your hands together like this. Yeah. I'm so blessed to be yours. It's a simple one. I'm so blessed to be yours. We say, I'm so blessed forever. Beautiful, let's do that again. I'm so blessed to be yours. Come on, declare. I'm so blessed to be yours. Say, Jesus, I'm so
We've been set free by the blood, forgiven,
forgiven
and redeemed.
And redeemed. Woo.
What you did, nothing can undo.
Come on, declare.
What you did, nothing. I'm so blessed, I'm so
blessed forever
to belong.
Woo! With our hands lifted, we declare now, say,
what you did, nothing can undo.
Nothing, nothing, nothing can undo.
What you did, nothing can undo.
Nothing, nothing, nothing.
Jesus, I'm so blessed forever to be alone.
Arate kanevali tomba shaila basiai.
Jesus, what you did, nothing can undo.
Nothing, nothing, nothing can undo.
What you did, nothing can undo.
Nothing, nothing, nothing.
We say I'm so blessed forever to be alone.
Let's use our voices one time. Together we say,
what you did, say,
what you did, nothing can undo.
We say,
what you did, nothing can undo.
I'm so blessed.
I'm so blessed forever to belong to you.
Hallelujah. Just give him thanks right now. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. There is a Redeemer,
sing it if you know it.
Jesus, God's own Son,
precious Lamb of God,
precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Oh,
sing, thank you, Lord,
thank you, oh my Father.
Forgiving us your Son
and leaving your Spirit to your work on earth.
Sing it one more time. Sing, thank you, Lord.
Forgiving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done.
You know this one.
And we will say that you are good. And all the miracles you've done have brought us joy. And we are changed. All the hopes we have,
we place in you right now.
Sing it again.
And we will say, and we will say
that you are good. And all the miracles you've done has brought us joy.
We are changed.
All the hopes we have,
we
place in you right now.
Father, we declare,
Father, we declare,
we love you. declare
everlasting love for you.
Father, we declare,
Father, we declare
that we love you, Lord. Sing from the top, lift your voice, and we will say, and we will say, you are good.
That you are good.
All the miracles.
And all the miracles you've done has brought us all. We're changed.
All the hopes we have.
We place in you right now.
One more time, lift your voice, and we will say,
you are good.
That we love
that
you.
We love.
We declare
everlasting love for you.
Father, we declare,
Father, we declare
that we love you, Lord.
Love you.
We declare
everlasting love for you.
Father, we declare, Father, we we love you because you loved us first. We sing, Father, Father, hey, we love you.
We
declare
everlasting love.
Sing it one more time from your heart. Father, we declare.
Father, we declare.
Oh, we declare
everlasting love for you.
Father, we declare, Father,
we declare,
Daddy, we love you, Lord.
We love
you. Daddy, we love you, Lord.
Everlasting love for you.
His presence is here. Just love upon him. Love upon him.
We love you, Lord. 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 We love you, Lord.
We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. For everything you've done for us, thank you. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you and we love you. We praise you today. We give you all the glory. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
Don't you love his presence? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. So, my God. Okay. All right. Hallelujah. All right. So, we're going to take our seats in a moment. I want you to do something very quickly. Just greet 5 people. You know, take your time with this. I'll give you time. All right. Just greet 5 people. Tell them, welcome to church. Ask their name.
All right, go ahead, do that right now. Five people. I'll give you time. Don't worry, do it. Hallelujah. All right, when you're done, you can take your seats. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You know, anytime I think of what God has done and the implications, It's the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Hallelujah. I think about the one big family we have become, and I'm just excited. Yeah. You know, Jesus speaking, he said, in my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. And so what Jesus did on the cross was make room for you, and 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 for you. So we belong. Not your neighbor, say you belong. Thank you, Father. Glory to God. How are you doing? Welcome to the month of April. Glory to God. The year is running so fast. Was it not yesterday I was saying Happy New Year to you? Amen. Hallelujah. All right. So, as it is our custom at Celebration Church, well, let me do this. If you're worshiping with us for the first time, I want to welcome you. All right. You're in the best place you could be on a Sunday morning, particularly those who are tuned in online, those who are watching from Winnipeg, from Calgary, from Kamloops, from British Columbia, from Montreal, everywhere we have a C church or a cell church. And those of us that are just tuned in online, I want to say the presence of God is there right where you are. There's no distance in the spirit. Just pay attention, tune in, and participate as though you were here in person. And every goodie that God has for you, you will receive today in the mighty name of Jesus. All right, so let's welcome them together. Say, welcome to church. God bless you. All right, as it is our custom at Celebration Church, every month we go through a series. A series is like we have, you know, Sunday services and midweek services, and we focus on a particular subject. And what we're going to be talking about in this month of April is very heavy. Is extremely important. It's extremely important. Let me say this thing. There's a song. It says, there's prophecy over you. You can't fail this one. Can we just sing that for 30 seconds? There is prophecy over me. I cannot fail this one. You can't fail. I cannot fail, my Lord. I must fulfill. There is prophecy. There is prophecy over me. I cannot fail this one. I cannot fail, my Lord. I go to one more time. There is prophecy. There is prophecy over me. I cannot fail this one. I cannot fail, my Lord. I must fulfill his cause. There is prophecy. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You see, a song like that is important because it exposes you to the fact that you have a heavy responsibility on your life. Maybe you haven't noticed. It's a heavy responsibility that the Lord has given you. And it is one that is a matter of life and death. It's one that is a matter of life and death. And so, as you go through this series, I want your heart to be open. You would hear some things you've heard before. They are great reminders. You will hear some things that are new to you. Examine them. Examine them. Because there is prophecy over you. What I've realized is, you know, many people don't know what a good sermon is. Many times, you know, a good sermon to some is the one that has all the jokes and, you know, all the puns and, you know, you were smiling all through. It's like a comedy show. And it's great. But in God's books, there are some things that weigh more. There's something the Bible calls weightier matters. Hallelujah. And so, the title of the series I'm going to be going through is Landmarks. Say landmarks. Landmarks. And a landmark could mean an ancient site or a monument. So, for example, if you were flying somewhere, or you were flying from anywhere, you're coming back to Toronto, and you know, 40 minutes towards landing, the pilots will announce, you know, well, start preparing for landing and all those things. It's usually 40 minutes. I don't know why. So just imagine he makes the announcement and, you know, you're sitting by the window and you look out the window. You're expecting to see the CN Tower because you are approaching Toronto. And what you see is the Eiffel Tower. Guess what? You've been kidnapped. Or maybe you start seeing pyramids. And the pilots say, do you understand what I'm saying? In the same way, when someone examines your faith, there are specific things that serve as landmarks that help you direct your position. And so you examine what you believe, peripursue what these landmarks are, just to know whether you are still standing or whether you need to adjust. The second thing, you know, landmarks are, even this is, you know, more direct. They are marks on land used to demarcate boundaries. So back in the day, you would see instructions in the Old Testament, remove not the ancient landmarks. Remove not the ancient landmarks. These were basically stones that they heaped to form a pillar to demarcate person A's land from person B's land. That's how the land of Israel, the promised land, was divided amongst the people. So they had those ancient landmarks, and the scripture was clear. Don't remove the ancient landmarks. If you apply that to your faith, it means the Christian faith is one that has boundaries. Your faith is one of landmarks. It's one of landmarks. Praise the name of Jesus. And so, Paul, understanding this, writes to you in Galatians chapter 1. He's saying, if anyone preaches to you a different gospel than the one I preach to you, let him be accursed. Jude wrote this. He said, I wanted to write to you about our common salvation, but instead, I'll write to you to contend earnestly, Jude 3, contend earnestly for the faith that was once and for all delivered unto the saints. He said to contend. So, two things here. First of all, he said contend for the faith. That tells you your faith is definite. There is something specific. It's a body of knowledge. Listen, maybe nobody has told you this. Do you know that the Bible has a specific focus? I know, maybe before you were somewhere else and he told you everything you ever need is in the Word. Is in the Word. Idea for business is in the Word. And you wake up in the morning, you are opening, trying to see something new about your career. Listen, you can take biblical principles and apply to your career. That's okay. But it's like approaching a book, a manual for flying a plane. And you take that, you say you want to apply it to your business, but you never learned how to fly the plane. That's how many of us live our lives. The Bible has a specific scope. It's definite. You call it the faith. If I say, get me a boy, you know that can be any boy. But if I tell you, get me the boy, you know I'm talking about a specific person. Don't be that person that enrolls in a flying school, in a pilot school, and you're given a manual, and then you take the principles of flying to apply to business, and the reason they sent you to school to learn to fly a plane, you didn't learn. Many people would learn about the parts of the plane. Oh, there's a cockpit. Oh, there's a door. Oh, there's an engine. There's a propeller and all those things. But you can't fly the plane. Don't focus on the minor. Your faith is specific. Say, my faith is specific. Say it again. My faith is specific. Second thing he said, contend for the faith that was handed once for all. It was delivered once for all unto the saints. You know what that means? Your faith is like a baton in a relay race. It is inherited. There's no room for innovation. It is so specific that God expects you to be faithful with it, such that if somebody commits the message to you, the same way you received it, you take it and you commit to the next generation after you. You know what that means? If Paul comes here today, by some means, he just appears here and is listening to our sermon, it has to tally with what he wrote about. It has to tally. It's not open to innovation. You know, funny enough, these days you hear so many things. I just wonder, things that Apostle Paul will hear, and in there, wherever he is in heaven, you'll be like, had he been, I know your name now. I will slap you. There's a lady I saw. She was preaching. She said this song, hey ya ya, hey ya ya, hey, it's so powerful. It's so powerful. You know why it's powerful? That she was reading Exodus, and she saw that when Moses asked God, who do you say sent me? God said, tell them I am. She checked the Hebrew word. What does I am mean? I am in the Hebrew is heya, heya, ya. And people were jumping. Oh my God, hey, glory. Ridiculous. Had it been, I know who she is. There's another one I saw. This one say, the best time to pray, oh my God. He said the best time to pray is in the AM. You know why? Because God, his name is I Am, so AM. I'm not joking. I'm not joking. I'm not joking. I promise you, I'm not joking. I promise you, I'm not joking. You see, if he said it, it's one thing. You know what irks me the most? People grow up jumping. Papa, right on. Hey, my God. Wow, mind blown. And I'm just like, what in the world is going on? What in the world is going on? Your faith is a heritage. It's a heritage. Paul was writing to Timothy. He said, the things you've heard of me, amongst many witnesses, what I told you, not in secret, the one I told you that everybody heard me tell you, take that and pass it on to faithful men who would pass it on to others also. It must be the same. Like a game of telephone. If I tell him the message, he tells everybody I get here, it must be the exact same thing. No innovation. No innovation. But guess what? A lot of people try to innovate because they have this mindset that the word of God is multifaceted. You know, what does the word of God say for me in this time, for my situation? And so when somebody tells you, oh, the Bible says this, you say, that's the way you see it. That's your view. That's your revelation. My revelation, stop that rubbish. Hallelujah. In Acts chapter 9. This is talking about the conversion of Paul, of Saul, right? Acts chapter 9. The Bible said, look at verse 1. Saul, breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest. Verse 2 says, and asked for letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of what? Not a way. Who were of the way. Meaning, whatever body of knowledge it is specific. Is specific. We'll talk about this a bit more as the month goes on. But listen, The curriculum of the Bible has a focus. The focus is this. The plan that God had to redeem man from the fall, the unfolding of the plan, the execution of the plan, and the results of the plan. That's all. That's what the Bible is about. This is not in my notes, but can you see how the apostles... Now, in the Old Testament, when you read up the story of David, what are the things that stand out to you? He killed Goliath. Beautiful. Wow, what a story. It's a story of grass to grace, a story of underdog. You know, all those beautiful stories. And children love the story so much. Oh, you know how to sling. Do like this. Oh, beautiful story. But then when the apostles were writing about David, they didn't mention it once. Because it's not a call. It's insignificant. What they wrote about David was the prophecies he told about Jesus. That should paint a picture in your mind. There's something very specific. Praise the name of Jesus. It is something very specific. So, if it is specific, so specific, how is it then that when we all read the Bible, we arrive at different bus stops? Research has it that there are about 45,000 denominations in the Christian faith. How? Only one Jesus. Only one. Baptist, Anglican, Catholic, Purist. Did someone say Mountain of Fire? You want to come? All of them. Lutheran. I won't say Luciferian. Lutheran, all of them. Pentecostal, charismatic, orthodox. Listen, your faith is orthodox. It's not a denomination. Orthodoxy is not a denomination. Your faith is orthodox. Orthodox means traditional. That's what your faith is. Hallelujah. When you read Ephesians chapter 4, he says he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry till we all come. That's what he said. Till we all come to the unity of the faith. When he says unity of the faith, you know, he wasn't talking about agreeing to disagree. And I said, you know what? We are one in Christ. So you think Jesus is an angel. I think he's God. It doesn't matter. As long as, you know, we are all God's children, let's agree to disagree. No. No. Granted, there are some things that are, you know, not as important, right? For example, how the rapture will happen, whether Jesus will come before tribulation or after tribulation, all those things, the Bible is not extremely clear. So people in interpreting what the Bible says in Revelations might have ideas and whatnot. But the point is, Jesus said he's coming again. Do you believe? I believe. That's it. I will not be here. Do you understand me? Say, oh, is it the camel? Jesus said it is easier for a camel to go to the eye of the needle. Was it a literal needle or was it the gate? It doesn't. It's easy. It's easy. Do you understand? But there are some things that cannot be negotiated. They are core. They can't be negotiated. And until we arrive at this point where we say, look, it doesn't matter, put ego aside. What does the Bible say? Because I cannot write a letter to you and you read it and somebody else in the same context reads it and gets a different message. It doesn't work that way. Does it make sense? If you had the code to detonate a bomb and you can only take one entry, you will sit down and argue it out. I think the answer is 969, not 696. You won't say, oh, this is my opinion. It's a matter of life and death. You know what the Bible says? It says the gospel of Christ is the power of God unto salvation. It's a matter of life and death. You must get it right. You must get it right. Hallelujah. He says, so that we will no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. You know what he's telling you? You know, there are some people, oh my God. There are some people who go to a church today. They hear one thing. They go to another church the next day the next Sunday, and they hear something that contradicts in its entirety what they heard on the first Sunday, and they are still blessed on both days. I was church, oh, I was blessed. He said, you will grow unto maturity, meaning your understanding of doctrine is proof of maturity. Not casting out devils. For God's sake, casting out devils is 101. He says, those that believe will be saved, those that don't believe will be damned. These signs will follow them that believe. It's basic. Praise the name of Jesus. So, understanding this, he tells you, you must contend for the faith. Say that when we say contend for the faith. Say contend earnestly for the faith. The word there, contend earnestly, is a Greek word, epagonizomai. Forget how long it is. But it basically means to compete as though you were in a competition. Listen, this is not a friendly match. There are lives at stake. He's telling you to contend. Fight for it. Fight for it. The reason why many people have landed in trouble is because they haven't placed doctrine at the level of importance as it should be. Granted, there are some people who go after doctrine just because they want to be puffed up and they want to show that they can quote Hebrew words and Greek words, and that's an extreme. But it doesn't mean doctrine is not important. It doesn't mean doctrine is not important. What does the Bible say about salvation, for instance? What does the Bible say about the gifts of the Spirit? What does the Bible say about the Holy Ghost? What does the Bible say about prayer? What does the Bible say about worship? What does the Bible say about money? All these things are important. And listen, it's a specific message. It's a specific message. Praise the name of Jesus. So he's telling you to contend. Listen, this contention is in two categories. First of all, within the body, you must come to a point where you're comfortable contending for the gospels, for sound doctrine, such that when you gather in a place and there's somebody from another church, you can sit down and say objectively, both of us read this and we arrive at the same answer. This is what the Bible is saying. Not your view, my view. Can I tell you something? Some people unknowingly elevate men over the word of God. It's just a subconscious thing they do. They don't know that they're doing it. So if somebody who is young, maybe someone like me, comes and says, the Bible says this is not what the Bible says now. Like, who are you? How long have you been in ministry? My father said, who are you? They've been doing it for years. Mm-mm. Whoever said it, let me tell you, the Bible is older than that person. So if you want to honor age, honor the word. It's older. If you want to honor, position and class, Jesus wrote these words. These are the words of God. So will you honor men over God? You must fight for this. But then there's another perspective. Let me say this. There is a way God made men to function. There is a way God made women to function. There's a natural law and order that God has set. There's a natural pattern. And if people in freedom are now trying to make a mess of God's order, it is left for his body to stand up and resist it. Do you understand what I just said? The Bible says a man shall leave his father and his mother and be cling to his wife, and they two shall become. He didn't say leave his father and his mother and cling to his brother. Listen, you're smiling. But do you realize that because we haven't stood up for what is right, many of the things that were unacceptable 15, 20 years ago are the norm of our day. the norm of our day. But a lot of us just sit down. We don't care. Ah. That's why I'm telling you. See, there's prophecy over you. You can't fail. You can't fail this one. Are you listening to me? You can't fail this one. You cannot. Praise the name of Jesus. Say, I can't fail this one. Say to yourself, I can't fail this one. You can't. You can't. So you're contending not just against wrong Christian doctrine, you're contending against falsehood in humanity. You're contending against falsehood in humanity. And it's important. It's extremely important. So all month long, we're going to talk about how to contend, you know, what it really truly means. How do we position ourselves to contend? There are two things I want to focus on today. First of all, one reason why many people struggle, more especially when it comes to the Christian faith, call it speed is speed. They are not knowledgeable. For many years, all we have done is come to church only when we have problems. And we don't want to know God for God's sake. We only want to know God to the extent at which he can solve our problems. And that has been the problem. So you come to church and you cry and you're emotional because you think that your bad habits is what is sponsoring the negativities in your life. So if I can just adjust and correct, God will see me and be like, ah, you are trying my daughter, you are trying my son. Well done, I will change your life. Am I saying the truth? Respond. That's the reason why many people are in church. Not because you really want to know about this God. And that's the exact same reason why somebody can preach a subject on relationships and this hall will be full. But then let's talk about salvation. You see empty chairs. Am I lying? See, let me just tell you something. If you're a member of this church, my job is to help you realign your priorities. My job as your pastor is to help you see the landmarks and so you can adjust. Such that if you're supposed to be flying a plane to Toronto and you are seeing pyramids, let's redirect the plane. That's my job. Are you listening to me? So don't be offended. Praise God. So the first thing you have to learn when it comes to contending, you have to know your stuff. How can you identify a fake when you don't know what the original looks like? How? And guess what? There are many people who have been in church for donkey years who cannot explain the basics. As a matter of fact, you know what the Hebrew writer says? The writer of Hebrews. What? You know what the writer of Hebrews says? He said, at some point he was writing, I don't remember the chapter now, but he said, you know, I really want us to go into the deep things. I want us to go into, you know, the next level. Let's go deeper in knowledge. But I can't. Why? Because you guys are not ready. That's what he said. He said, up until now, we still need to feed you milk. Imagine you have a 5-year-old. Who is still doing like this, crying, mama, milk, milk, milk. I feel like that's how the writer of Hebrews was thinking. Like at this age, at your age, since you are still feeding you milk. Guess what? What the Bible was talking about milk. Now, he said, I can't go into deeper things. Let's focus on what is basic. And he started explaining ordinances, blood, atonement, all those things you read in Leviticus. He was not trying to explain them. What we read today and say, that's deep. He said it's basic. Are you seeing the problem?
Yes, sir.
He said those are basic. But in our day, that's deep stuff. Wow. I understand salvation is deep. Mm-mm. He said it's basic. But guess what? If you call any Christian, 9 out of 10 cannot properly explain the gospel. They can't. I'll tell you for free. The gospel is not come to the Lord and he will turn your life around 360. You were poor, he will make you rich. That is not the gospel. It's not the gospel. They've deceived you. It doesn't make sense that you are coming to church to hear, quote unquote, a gospel that someone died for, only to receive things that people could have received without him. Look at it, Forbes' richest men. Many of them are not Christians. Have you realized? So how can you tell me that Jesus came to waste his time, to die for your laziness? That's what it is. You say, oh, if you come to Christ, there will be no suffering. Listen, the people who preach this thing, people who follow Jesus, they were 12 at the beginning. Do you know 11 of them died? Only one did not die a horrific death. But guess what? He was banished. They tried to kill him. They couldn't. So they banished him to an island. Only you. Go and die of loneliness. All of them died. If you go by the message that is preached today, they would not have believed the gospel. Because what they experience is the complete opposite of what we are hoping and praying for. We can't even stomach trials. We can't stomach persecution. Because they promise us, God will wipe the tear away. What is the gospel? What is the gospel? Because at the end of the day, see, we must believe the same thing. The goal of God is what we just read, unanimity of faith, where we're not tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. The gospel cannot be by grace through faith and at the same time by obeying the law. It can't be. It's either we are both wrong or one person is right. We can't both be right. Whatever you believe about the Holy Ghost, especially when they are contradicting, they can't both be right. Then, well, God, his ways are not our ways. You are wrong. You are wrong. Just imagine you're flying a plane and then there are two buttons. One is green, one is blue. If you press the green one, the engine will come on. If you press the red one, the engine will go off. And you're telling me, yeah, no worry, anyone you press is fine. You are wrong. You will die. You will not die in Jesus' name. You will live to declare the works of the Lord, the land of the living. But my point is, when it comes to the things of the faith, the messages are specific. Your faith is specific. You ought to be interested in it. You ought to be interested in growing in the specifics, knowing what the Bible truly says. Give yourself to it. Give yourself to learn. Give yourself to learn. You know what I hope for? I just pray that you will realize this before it's too late. How important this concept is. How important teachings like these are. Listen, I'm not just saying this because this is Celebration Church. It is not every church you can attend. Do you know that? It's not every church you can go to. It's not every pastor you can listen to. God knows. I'm not saying this just so I can keep you here. But it's not every pastor you can listen to. Praise the name of Jesus. So this is why the subject of landmarks are important. Because again, no matter how old the message, you know, some people think, you know, the message can evolve. It was not good. I mean, back in the day, there are traditions and everything. So today, it's a new, we're a new generation. We have a new way of thinking. So those practices are old and archaic, and they don't fit our day. No. It is specific. If it worked back then, it's still the same today. It has not changed. Did you hear what I just said? So it matters what you believe. And so this month, we're going to visit some of those landmarks. The landmark of salvation. What exactly does it mean that a man is saved? Why did Jesus have to die? What does circumcision mean? What is the anointing? What is communion for? What exactly do you believe? Hallelujah. So, let's talk about salvation today. Look at the Bible. Look at what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1. Turn your Bibles with me. Ephesians chapter 1 from verse 13. Ephesians chapter 1 from verse 13. Can we all read it together? One, two, go. He said there's a particular message you heard. He called it the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. He said when you received it, you believed it, you were sealed. He called it the word of truth. That means there's a specific message to believe to be saved. There's a specific message. Praise the Lord. And so in Galatians chapter 1, I talked about this already. Paul was writing. He says, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who has called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. So you are moving from what I preach to you to a different gospel. He says, which is not another. Meaning there's really no other one. It's just fake. But then there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven, see how grandiose this is. He said, I gave you a message. If I come back tomorrow and tell you what I preach to you is wrong, don't listen to me. I'm the one that taught you. But he says, if I come back and change mouth, don't listen. That's how intense it was. He says, if we or an angel from heaven preach, do you know that many of the sects, the cults and the sects that we have in our day to day, do you know how they started? Jehovah's Witness, do you know how he started? Mormonism, do you know how he started? The founders had their own personal revelation. Listen, even Islam started that way. We'll unpack those some other time. But he said, if anybody comes and preaches to you a different message, let him be accursed. So what exactly is the gospel? I love the definition our apostle gave. He said, the gospel is this, and I want you to write it down. Some of you are familiar with this already, but just in case you're not, this is something I would like you to write down. Here it goes. It says, God has fulfilled his plan to accept the death of his son, Jesus, as the propitiation for our sins. Is that too fast? God has fulfilled his plan to accept the death of his son, Jesus. God has fulfilled his plan to accept the death of his son, Jesus, as the propitiation, as the payment, the atonement for our sins, and has ever since bestowed righteousness on anyone who believes in Jesus. Glory to God. He has accepted the death of his son Jesus as payment, propitiation, atonement, ransom for our sins, and has ever since then bestowed righteousness on anyone who believes in Jesus. I can spend all day talking about this, unpacking each section and just going into it. But I want to answer three questions. If you're really truly going to understand the concept of salvation, what the Bible really truly preaches, there are three questions that I want to try to answer today. Number one, what is man being saved from? Number two, why did Jesus eventually have to die? And then number three, what happened to the people who were alive before Jesus came? So, let's go through very quickly. Number one, what does man need saving from? This is the beginning of the whole salvation story. You must understand, man owed a debt he could not pay. I want to read some portions of scripture to you. Look at Romans chapter 6 and verse 23. We're going to read the first part together. Romans 6 and verse 23. Are you ready? One, two, go. You said you were ready. Romans 6:23. Are you there? Open your Bibles, please. Are you ready now? Read together. One, two, go. He said the wages of sin is death. This is a very, very, very profound statement. If you are engaged in sin, the punishment is death. And so, man entered into a state of helplessness because of what Adam did. Now, in Genesis chapter 2, in Genesis chapter 3, the devil came and deceived the man, and the man fell. He rebelled against God. And on account of his rebellion, you know what God told him? God said, if you eat of this fruit, you will surely die. Is that true? Question, did Adam die?
Yes, sir. Not physically.
No, not physically. Not physically. Did Adam die? God said, he gave him instructions. If you eat of this fruit, you will surely, God said, you will surely die. So Adam, let me tell you this. Do you realize when the Bible says all that God created was good? Man was created not to die. Man was created to live in harmony with God forever. This was God's plan. But because of the rebellion, man died physically. And, you know, so the physical death came supposedly later, right? But at that point, death, spiritual death is separation from God. He was separated from God. So man died spiritually and physically. Even though the physical one came later on, that's why Jesus at some point could, you know, he was going somewhere and he was calling disciples, says, come, follow me. And one of them said, oh, I want to go and bury my dead. You know what he said? He said, let the dead bury their dead. You follow me. Meaning every human is in a state of spiritual death without Christ. So in Romans 6, he then tells you the wages of sin is death. On account of the sin of Adam, every other man is implicated. Every other man is implicated. So some people would, you know, if you ask a Canadian on the streets, for example, they tell you, I'm a good person. I haven't stolen. you know, the funny thing is, if you ask them, what they try to do is to gauge their faults by some sort of compass to say, well, mine was not so bad. I just slapped somebody. I didn't kill him. So, I mean, I haven't killed anyone. The ones that are killed are the ones that should perish, not me. That's what they think. But listen, sin is sin. The Bible says, if the Lord counts iniquity, none will stand. So you must understand how helpless you were in this scenario. The beginning of salvation is understanding the utter helplessness of man. There is absolutely nothing you would have done to pay this debt that you owed. And now, based on what I explained, it means what Adam went through. What Adam, you know, the reason why it applies to you is simple. Now, when God created man, when God wants to create, he doesn't create man one, man two, woman one, woman two, and then create 1,000. He creates one and blesses it with the ability to multiply after its own kind. That's how God created. So he created Adam, and then from Adam created Eve, and then from those two, everybody you see in the world today. And so Adam in the Hebrew means mankind. It's not really a name like John. It's symbolic and significant, meaning whatever happened to Adam, he was a representative of the whole of mankind. So when you read in Romans chapter 5, it tells you because of one man's disobedience, sin came into the world, and through sin, death. That's how. So listen, even if you come into this world and you are a saint, which you are not, you are not. Don't ask me how I know. I'm a man of the spirit. You are not. Okay, not in this church. Not in this church, outside. Praise the Lord. Even if you didn't have anything, you have not stolen a pen before. You have not looked at a woman lustfully. The person that said, is a woman. So is he, is he a woman looking at a woman? Let's just say, you've not stolen, you've not coveted your neighbor's property before. You've not called the name of the Lord in vain. You've not sworn before. You've not used curse words. You've always honored your father and your mother. Always. The problem is, a lot of people have this self-righteous perspective. And so they think, it's not that bad. Mm-mm. Sin is bad. In the Bible, the Greek word is, I forget what it is, hamartia or something like that. It basically means to miss the mark. It might seem very trivial. But here the Bible is telling you the wages of sin is death. It's a matter of life and death. So the fact that you exist as a human, you're already implicated. Unless you didn't come from Adam. Which you did. So you're implicated. Helplessness means you cannot help yourself. There's nothing you would have done. Guess what? They tried. They tried. God gave them laws. Okay, you must follow all these laws. Follow this. They failed woefully. Didn't work. Hallelujah. So, just in case there's anybody asking, I thought it was Adam. Why does it apply to me? Bible says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All. Since there's no one righteous, not even one. Nobody. See, stop trying by your efforts. It won't work. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Do you know that there are some people who don't believe in God and are more righteous than you? It won't work for them still. So man has fallen short. That's the beginning. That's the starting point. You must recognize where you stand. You are helpless. You know, I saw a video one time. There was a duck that had about 8 ducklings. That's what they're called, right? The young of a duck is a duckling.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. 8 ducklings. And so they were just going about, you know? And there was a manhole. You know these holes that they dig? I don't know what they do inside. But those holes that they cover with... What they covered with still... The holes were still big enough for a young duckling to fall in. So the mother, for some reason, was just going and just walked over it and passed. And all of a sudden, she turned back and saw that all her ducklings had fallen in there. Now, these are ducks. They don't have technology of send a rope, pull them out. So all the mother could do was just perambulate, just be walking around it and be intensifying her voice. Bah, 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 bah. Helpless. That's a picture of helplessness. There's nothing you would have been able to do to get yourself out of that manhole. You are helpless. Except for the sovereign intervention of an external party. And so, as video was there, the dog was running around. Somebody came in a truck and then used a material to open up the manhole, go inside by himself, and one by one, start bringing out the ducklings. One by one. Until all of them came out. It took an external entity. So you're asking, why did Jesus have to die? That's why. Because by your own self, your efforts would not count. Your efforts won't count. Now, there's another question in there. Why did Jesus have to really come and die? We know that the payment had to be made. But is God not God? Why didn't he just say, I am God. I made you. I forgive you. Is that a good question or not?
Yes, sir.
Have you thought about that before?
Yes.
Let me read a portion of scripture to you. Look at Psalm 116. Psalm 116 and verse 5. Psalm 116 and verse 5. I want us to read this together. Psalm 116 and verse 5. Are you ready? Please open. Please open your Bible. This is so important. Open your Bibles. Let's read it together. Psalm 116 and verse 5. Let's read together. 1, 2, go. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yes, our God is merciful. He says, gracious is the Lord and righteous. Righteous means he is just. He judges right. Listen, listen. In the legal system, if you have a judge that is judging a case, right? Your verdict, when you listen to what the judge's decision is one of two things. You either say, oh, this judge is just. Or you say, oh, this judge is merciful. He can't be both. If somebody has an offense, and you say, no, somebody must pay for this. And he comes and he says, I'm sorry, you owe the debt, you must pay. You say what? He's a just judge. So the people on the defense who were trying to say, oh, please help us not to pay, they'll say he's a wicked God. He's a wicked judge. He's just, he's not merciful. On the flip side, if he were to go, you know what? The payment, don't worry, go, don't pay, go free. The people who really needed that payment will say, this guy is wicked. But then the other guys are saying he's merciful. Are you seeing? So a judge cannot be both. Unless you are God. Unless you are God. So he's saying, gracious is the Lord. He is righteous. He is merciful. How come? There was a debt to be paid. Yes, but he paid it himself. So when the people who are saying they must pay, when they see the payment. On the other side, they're saying, please, we can't pay, we can't afford it. He's telling them go scot-free because he has brokered it. Do you understand what I'm saying? So David saw this and he goes, our God is righteous and at the same time he is merciful. Glory to God. So why did Jesus have to die? The price had to be paid. That tells you how grievous the offense was. It took the blood of Jesus. It's not just by, oh, you know, Lord, I forgive, you know. When you come and say a prayer. So you come and say a prayer, Lord, I repent. I will not do it again. I'm sorry. Forgive me. Listen. It's deeper than that. The next time you want to go do something, just think about the price somebody paid for you. That in and of itself sometimes will restrain you. It will. Praise the Lord. So he paid the price. And then he's now telling you, if you want to be saved, all you have to do is believe in my sacrifice. Look at Romans chapter 10. Oh my God, this is going to bless you. Romans chapter 10 and verse 6. He says, the righteousness of God speaks in this way. Now, he's telling you there are two kinds of righteousness. There are some people who think they can attain righteousness by God, by their works. Then there's another group of people who know that works won't cut it. So he's telling you the kind of righteousness that works is this. He said, it is not the one that says in the heart, who will ascend to the heaven, talking about works, right? Where Christ is, you know, and bring him down from above, or who will descend into the abyss and bring Christ up from the dead. He's talking about works. Who will do the work? So you think it's about the works that you do? He said, no, it's not. Verse 8 says, he says, what does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Verse 9, everyone read together. 1, 2, go. He said, all you have to do is just confess it with your mouth and believe it in your heart. Confess with your mouth and believe it with your heart. That's all. That's the requirement. Because your righteousness, your own righteousness, as filthy rags. They won't count. Are you listening to what I'm saying? I remember I went to preach somewhere in Hamilton. This was my teaching. I preached this. And the lady came to me after the service. It couldn't sink. Like, she didn't understand. Are you saying? What do you... So, I don't have to scale a mountain. You know that song by Domoen? High every mountain, cross every ocean, just to be with... You've not heard it before. Update your playlist. That's what many people think this thing is about. So, you have to do the work and fight for it.
But he's telling you, just believe in his sacrifice. My brothers, my sisters, it's that simple. Just believe. The Bible says God chooses the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. So many people are thinking, back then, they thought it's only the wealthy that will make heaven. Because this is so great a price, somebody has to pay a lot of money and whatnot. But then Jesus comes and says it's free. Listen to me, my brothers and my sisters. Salvation is free. It's free. He's only asking you to believe. Some people think for you to come to the Lord, you have to come in a certain kind of way. You have to clean up your hair and, remove your tattoos. No! Come the way you are. It's free. It's free. Jesus paid the price. Say, Jesus paid the price. There is nothing you will do today or tomorrow that will enhance or reduce it. He paid the price in full. We change. Hallelujah. Now, see what he says in Romans 10 and verse 11. Oh my God. Romans 10 and verse 11. Everyone read together. 1, 2, go. He said, whoever believes on me will not be put to shame. Meaning, the promise I have made you, I will fulfill. There's nothing to be ashamed of. It won't fail. You can take this to the bank. That's what he's saying. This is a scripture of assurance. And so he then says, there's no Jew or Greek. It doesn't matter who you are or what you've been. It doesn't matter what your past is. He says, whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Glory to God. Whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Listen, I've come to tell you this morning, you don't have to climb a high mountain or scale an ocean. All you have to do is believe in your heart. Believe it in your heart. Now, you know what the devil wants to do? A message as sincere as this, as simple as this, he wants to complicate it. He wants to pervert it. Bible says the God of this world has blinded the eyes of them who are not of the faith, lest they see the light that is in the face of Jesus. He has blinded their eyes. So something as simple as this is so hard for them to accept. Why is it so hard for you to accept? That somebody paid a price for you? Hallelujah. Listen, if you have believed, his blood has covered for you. And it covers for you until eternity. Say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'll give you a moment. Just give him thanks right now. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name. Listen, why is it important to contend? First of all, understand this message so you can preach it to people and so you can stand against falsehood. Do you realize that there are people, not even of the faith, people outside of the faith that think there are many ways to God? Listen, there are not many ways. Jesus himself came and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody will smell it except through me. He said, no one will come to the Father except by me. Apostle gave a wonderful analogy. Apostle Emmanuel Aaron is the lead pastor of this church. Wonderful analogy this morning when he preached from our headquarters. Basically comparing the story of Noah. Because many times in the Bible, there are two kinds of prophecies you see. Some are, spoken prophecies where a prophet comes on the scene and says, thus says the Lord, yada, yada, yada. Yada, yada. Thus says the Lord, this and that, this and that. But sometimes there are dramatized prophecies. Dramatized prophecies. Such that the life of a man, everything that is happening in his life is telling a story. So the Israelites were complaining in the wilderness at some point, and then the Lord told him, you know, so because of their murmuring, snakes came out of the bush and was biting them and killing them as punishment, right? And then God told Moses, make a brazen serpent and lift it up. And whoever has been bitten by a snake on the ground but can look to that serpent, the person will be healed instantly. And then Jesus comes and says, as Moses lifted up a brazen serpent, the Son of Man would also be lifted. And says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men. Meaning, the same way that brazen serpent was lifted up, the people didn't have to do any work. All they had to do was just look on the serpent and will be saved. In the same way, all you have to do is just look on Jesus and you will be saved. It's a prophetic picture. There are so many like that in the scriptures. The Exodus from Egypt, a prophetic picture of baptism into Christ. So the life of Noah was also a picture. And I want you to take some time. Time is fast spent. Take some time. When you get back home today, listen to his teaching. It will bless you tremendously. Tremendously. One part that he spoke about that really blessed me was when he said, God gave him instructions on how to build the ark, right? But then God specifically told him to coat the wood, to rub a layer of asphalt. He called it pitch. Rub it inside and outside. The reason is asphalt is a water-resistant material. And it's extremely important because the kind of flood that happened back then, anything you put on it, how come it was only the ark that survived? Everything else was wiped off. So if there was no water-resistant material on the ark would not have survived. And when you now check the Hebrew translation of what that word pitch means, in Hebrew, the word was used somewhere else to mean ransom. So meaning the same way the ark was put, the pitch, the asphalt, the bitumen was put on the ark. And it seemed like it was a way to protect the ark from water coming in. That same way, the blood of Christ is ransomed on you and protects you. So beautiful. But one more thing you must know about that ark. That ark had only one door. There was no other entrance. God told him, make one door. So if you think of the ark as salvation, there is only one way in. And when all the animals and Noah and his family had entered, they were not the ones that closed the door. God closed it himself. Basically means your efforts would not count. God was the one who closed the ark himself. My friends, I'm telling you, there is still only one way. Oprah Winfrey will tell you, I don't believe there are multiple ways to God. It's a lie. There's only one way. And this is why you must stand and defend your faith. They have money. They have influence. What they say, the quote and unquote masses will go, that's true. The problem many of us have is we think there's this mindset we have. You know, the Bible says you can't do anything against the truth but for the truth. Have you seen that in your Bible? And sometimes we say, oh, you know, what will be, will be. And so we think truth will prevail by itself. It's not true. Let me tell you something. Whatever ideology prevails in our day is an ideology that is sponsored. So if there are people who are intentional and propagating false agenda that is counter to your faith, you can't just stand idly by. You can't afford that. Do you really believe there's only one way?
Yes,
then you must act as though there is only one way, because it's a matter of life and death. Praise the name of Jesus. You must act as though there's only one way. Truth cannot spread by itself. Truth will not spread by itself. If truth would spread by itself, there would be no Turkey today. The country. That country is 99% Muslim. This is where Apostle Paul lived. Hey God, do you know how serious that is? This is where the apostles lived. The city of Ephesus, where the Bible says the word of God grew mightily and prevailed. That is Turkey today. When good men fold their arms, evil has a free day. Because I'm telling you, evil is sponsored. Think about the ideologies that you are seeing in and around. They will first come and they will shame the truth. Shame the truth. Drag it to an extreme. So all of you now, they not tell you, oh, you know, you should be neutral. You know, in our day, people don't love to play the neutral card. You know, you fight for advocacy. Let all men believe. That's how they start. This movement, that's how it started. All men have rights. And so when you become neutral, the people that are neutral will now join them to fight those who are resisting. In the name of neutrality. Until it gets to the point where they pushed you too far. You that was neutral before, you now be wondering, what have I done? That's what's happening. Do you know there are many people who are coming out to say this whole transition thing is hazardous to health? Do you read the news? But it's too late. The train has long gone. Because we're neutral. Just imagine if in South Africa, when apartheid was happening, just imagine if Nelson Mandela and his people were neutral. God sees, isn't he a God of justice? God will arise, and at the end of the day, it will be cool. You have to do something. You have to do something. You have to do something. For two reasons. Number one, listen. Beyond just doctrine, listen to me carefully. Beyond just doctrine, do you know that this faith that you practice has a lot more benefits to the society than you know of? Statistically proven. It is statistically proven that people who are Christians have better relationships. They live longer. Why? Because on account of their faith, they would abstain from vices in the world. They don't drink, they don't smoke, they don't sleep around, and all those. So they are healthier. As a matter of fact, some people who are bitterly against the faith, atheists, Richard Dawkins, they interviewed him and he said that he would rather live in a Christian society. At least they have good values. That's what he said. We know that the values we have are on account of our faith. But they also know that if we are not there, the world is going to just go down, spiral down into a world of wickedness and hatred. They know. In Christian societies, there's more trust. Because you know, your faith is found in God. You live by godly principles. You are accountable to God. So you care for your neighbor. There's evidence. Think about it. All the schools, the Ivy League schools, do you know that the Ivy League schools were founded by Christians? Harvard University was founded by a Christian. It was a school of theology. Oxford, Cambridge, they were founded by Christians. So you can never rule out the influence of Christianity in the world today, even in the West. So the story of, oh, Christianity has not contributed, is wrong. It's not true. Think, look through history. So if your faith is that valuable, why are you hiding? Why are you not doing anything? And beyond the benefits that you stand to get, beyond the benefits in the society and all of that, Jesus is telling you there's only one way into the ark. So if you know that way, you found that way, are you so wicked as not to share the way with your neighbor? Do you have a heart? So now, they look at you and somebody asks you, who are you? I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. What's your final destination? The new earth, right? Our destination is not heaven. Sorry for that day. But paradise. Let's say paradise. So I'm going to reign with Christ forever. I have eternal life. That's my life. And then you look at your neighbor and you claim to love your neighbor and you have not told the neighbor the same thing. So we know that at some point that neighbor would not experience what you're experiencing. They will be damned forever. And you can't tell them why you are shy. Listen to yourself for a second. You are shy. Paul says, contend earnestly. Contend earnestly. And listen, you're not going to have all day. Have you not noticed that sometimes you might have someone in your family who doesn't know the message? You're playing around. And then they fall sick. They're on their sick bed. That's when all the confidence comes. You now go to them and you're shaking them. Repeat after me. Repeat after me. Why wait till then? Don't remove the ancient landmarks. There's only been one way. There will only be one way. I might sound, you know, like a bigot if somebody else hears me say this, but it's been proven the Christian way is superior. It's superior. You must wear this badge on your chest and be confident. Be confident in it. Praise the name of Jesus. The last portion of the scripture, and then we close. Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. I want us to all read this together. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. And listen, we're going to read this. I want you to read it with gusto. Read it like a soldier. Read it like one who is convinced it is true. Read it like one who knows the implication of what you're saying. Because it's true. Are you ready? Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Read together. 1, 2, go. Read it one more time. 1, 2, go. It says there is no other name given amongst men. No other name. No other name. Do you believe there is no other name? Act like it. Live like it. You don't have time. Act like it. You know, sometimes when I say, oh, whatever you learned at church, post on your social media, people look at me like, oh, what's wrong with this one? It's antics to get clout or something. Don't post, don't worry. You have neighbors who have never heard. Listen, the fear some of you have, number one, you don't know what to say. That's why I said the beginning of contention is learning the message. Know how to interpret the message. And there are materials everywhere. If you attend this church for 4 months, you will know the gospel. I'm telling you. Ask around. So, I don't know it will no longer be an excuse. For some, it is that they are afraid. Afraid of being cancelled. Afraid of, you know, they'll see you as a, you know, you are not woke. These are actual fears. Yes. But let me tell you something. Everybody you get the opportunity to speak to, you know what you're doing? You are sowing a seed. Sometimes you speak to someone and the person just starts crying and gets convicted. You think it's only you? 99 people have sown seed. You are just 100th person. You are the one that put the final drop in the bottle that made it full. But there are some people you will encounter, you are the one putting the first drop. So if they say no, you have sown the seed. Don't worry. Be bold in your commitment to the gospel. But now, some people, because they say, you're only going to sow seed and whatnot, so they just talk to one person and the person doesn't respond, that's it. They're done. They're done. Not so. There will be people you would meet where you will sow seed and go. There will be other people you would meet that you would die on their matter. Are you listening to me? Listen, there are some of you who can argue for your football club. They don't know you. They're not paying you. You can convince somebody to become an Arsenal fan. Now you can convince them because... Will you keep quiet? Shut up there. I know your voice since now. I'm joking. But just imagine, your club has not been doing well since. You still stood with pain. Arsenal fans, so confident. Oh, let's use Man U now. Man U fans, or Chelsea, You can die on their matter, whether or not they're performing. but then the gospel, you think you cannot do it. Listen, listen. There are connections you have built in your life. People trust you. There are people in your circle that trust you. Why not sit down with them one day and say, come, this thing, this message, this is what it is. Oh, don't take it with levity. If you can't explain it well, bring them to church. Let them hear it. And that's why we say post. Because I can't reach everybody. There are people in your sphere of influence that are not in mine. Are you listening to me? If I see them on the street, for example, and I come to talk to them, I don't have gray hair. The hair is even going. Do you understand? I don't have. So they won't see me as this old wise man. They may not listen to what I have to say. But they have you. You've built relationships with them. Use it. Let God use your boots. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Let God use your boots. This is something you must change from today. Stand up for what is right. And more especially as it pertains to your faith, don't let people off the hook easily. Jude said, you know, he would fight such that, you know, we're going to snatch people from the fire. I think it was Charles Spurgeon who said that, I'm going to preach on you and, you know, fight for you such that if you get to hell, they will see that my hand was holding you. As they're entering hell, they see somebody's hand. It's like, meaning he was fighting until the last moment. That's what it means to contend. God wants to do a work in this city. And he's asking for you to play a part. He's asking for you to play a part. There is no other name given amongst men by which they will be saved. Please stand to your feet. I want us to pray two prayers. First off, with an understanding of what Christ has done for you. He paid your debt. Even when you didn't realize that you needed saving, he died for you. And he has given you eternal life for free. You didn't have to earn it. A priceless gift placed on your lap only by your believing. Nothing would have attained this for you except by his grace, except by his mercy, except by his sacrifice. So in the next 30 seconds, I want you to lift your voice and just appreciate him from your heart. Say, thank you, Lord, for dying for me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, because of your sacrifice, I have hope of eternal life. Because of your sacrifice, I have hope of eternal life. Thank you, because you have taken away all my sin and reproach. The Bible says there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. I thank you, because my sin and my shame don't count against me anymore. You wiped my slate clean. Your word says if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. And all things have become new. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you because your blood has atoned for me. Thank you because of what you have done, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. David spoke about me. He spoke about the blessedness of a man to whom God will not impute sin. He was talking about me. I thank you. Because my sins don't count against me. Thank you because you have forgiven me of my sins. You are no longer angry with me. You are not angry with me. Thank you. Because your wrath was exhausted on Christ on the cross. All that is left is love. All that is left is love. All that is left is love. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. The second prayer, I'd like you to pray and then we close. The Bible says he died for all. So we who now live should no longer henceforth live unto ourselves, but for the one who died for us and rose again. Meaning he died and gave you his life so you can live for him. The entirety, the summation of your life ought to be the will of God. And his will is that all men come to the knowledge of the truth. So you're going to pray, Lord, I receive strength. I receive wisdom and I open up myself to be used for your cause, that many would come to know you by my efforts. Many people around me in my sphere of influence would come to know you on account of my efforts. I lend my boat to you. I lend my resources to you. I lend my time and my energy to making sure that everyone in my sphere of influence learns about this message, learns about you, and they have the same hope that I have. Pray from your heart right now. Pray from your heart right now. The gospel is more than bread. The gospel is more than bread. More than bread. My Lord, I change my perspective. Not only are you Savior, you are Lord. And so I open up myself to receive you, not just for the bread that you give, but for the bread that you are. And I live with purpose. I live with purpose to know you and to make you known, to contend earnestly for the faith that was once and for all delivered unto the saints. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Father, we thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you because you've changed our lives. On account of what you have done, we can stand boldly and declare that we are your righteousness, because you are our grace. Thank you because there is no condemnation for us in this room, because we have put our trust in you. We have put our faith in you. We thank you because the Bible says those who put their faith in you would not be put to shame. Your word says whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We've called on your name and we've experienced salvation. We thank you. We thank you. And even as we have received salvation, the Bible says if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away and all things have become new. Our ambitions are new. Our ideologies are new. Our passions are new. And they pant after you to see your dream fulfilled. And so if you want all men, we'll go for all men. If you want everyone in my vicinity, everyone in my sphere of influence to know you and to be saved, we would go for all men. As you give the grace, as you give the wisdom, as you open up doors of opportunity, we will not waste them. We thank you. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Come on, celebrate Jesus in this place. Hallelujah. All right, take your seats in a very quick moment. Let's package our offerings as we bring the service to a close. Listen, by way of admonition, I want to say three things. Number one, be vocal about the gospel. Be vocal about the faith. If you stand aside and do nothing, your faith would not triumph. Your faith will not win. That's not how to contend. So when you see something that is wrong, stand up for it. For what is right. Stand up for what is right. Okay? So learn to be vocal about your faith in your sphere of influence. There are people who have never heard this gospel's message that are within your reach. So be vocal about the gospel to them. I don't have to be there. God sees. I know, oh my goodness, there's a lady in this church who just came as a regular person. But for the past 6 months or even more, I've noticed how she brings her friends almost every Sunday. She's bringing somebody new. And they come to me to say, oh, Pastor Brian, meet this new person, meet that new person. It warms my heart so much, so much. Not just because, oh, the church is growing, it's great. But the people she's impacting, when she meets Jesus, it will be reckoned to her account that on account of the fact that she brought them here, they were saved. That can be you. And you never know. The next person, God, you know, the anointing will cover the person. The person will do great and mighty things for the Lord. Maybe it was you who would win that person. Listen, it will be credited to your account. So be vocal. Be intentional. Be intentional. Learn about the gospel. If you need materials, we will give you materials. We are big on discipleship at this church. We believe that, you know, you don't just come to the faith and be the same position in the same place. You don't know knowledge for 15 years and you say you're a believer. No, there ought to be growth and it's measurable. It's measurable. So go for knowledge. Ask questions. That's how you grow. I say this all the time. The sign of a good Bible student is in the questions they ask. If you're not asking questions, you're not studying. At the very least, even if you've asked the questions and you found the answers, then that means you had the questions and then you found the answers somewhere. You can't not have questions. So ask questions. Okay? So if you can't explain it, bring them here. We will explain it as God gives us the grace. Leverage your social media. Post about it. Listen. Think about this. You know, this thing is like an evangelism drive. Just imagine everybody here brought one person to church. Just imagine that. There will be no space. But the fact that we have space, it means that some people are not evangelizing. Listen, take it seriously. Because it matters. It matters. If you can't explain it, bring them. Come. There's this church I go to. Come. Come. Let's go. Come. Bring them. Hallelujah. And then post about it. It's a simple message. What did I learn at church today? See, you guys will sing, my lifetime, I will give God my life. But you can't give God your timeline. Yeah. Hey! Stop it. That was good. Wow. It came from somewhere. I don't know. Now, those that are saying, that was good. Praise God. If you want to give the Lord your lifetime, give him your timeline. Oh my God. Is it people that are enabling this? All right. Sorry? It came from Eden. It wasn't hidden. I'm sorry now. Oh my God. So post about it. I went to this church. They talked about salvation. It's free. Something simple and basic. You don't have to download the whole sermon. It's great if you can. Some of you do it. You tag me. It's beautiful. I will repost. But don't just keep silent. Some of you are influencers in this church and they've not seen not talk of Jesus on your timeline. I'm telling you, it's wrong. You know what Jesus said? He said, if you are ashamed of me, I will be ashamed of you. My God. People don't talk about it in church anymore. If you are ashamed of me, I will be what? So, there will be people that you're going to speak to on the train, on your way to the office. So some of those people, you only get to encounter them once. So you speak to them once and then you sow the seed and you go. But there are some people that at least one person a year, make it a goal. There must be one person that at the end of the year will say, oh, who are you mentoring, Dick Amsi? Who is the person you're mentoring? And you say, this person. This person used to be on the streets, was not saved. But because I invested, so I brought them into at least one person a year. Make it a goal. Make it a goal. Don't just be going about living life like vida loca. You can set spiritual goals. One, make it a goal in this church. At least one person. So December, we'll say, okay, this is the person. You bring your own person and they will meet. And then next year, we'll send them out. Day two, they will go and bring another person. You go and bring another person. That's how the body grows. Praise the name of Jesus. All right, so let's do that. I mean it too. I really do. All right. So look for somebody that you want to bring in. Look for that person. I think about stories of somebody like Nabil Qureshi. staunch Muslim. Because of him, many Christians has tackled them. They felt that, do you understand? But then there was this roommate he had. He said, you, are we? So he knew that this roommate of his, no matter what, had his back. And on account of the efforts of this roommate, whose name was David Wood, Nabi Qureshi got saved. Now, he's passed on to glory. Just imagine, he just lived and he wasted, just like that. The worth of his soul is precious in the eyes of God. It has to be precious in your own eyes as well. All right, are we going to do this? Are we going to do this? Please do it. Don't let my 1 hour here be a waste. All right, so let's bring our service to a close. Let's take our offerings. Ways to give would appear on the screen. If you want to give cash, though, there are protocol team members with envelopes going around the aisle. Please make sure to get an envelope from them and give through that means. Write your name legibly just so we can give tax receipts at the end of the year. Okay? Have you guys done that? Okay. All right. I want to say a big thank you to everyone who gives week in, week out. To those who give their tithes every month, I want to say thank you. Now, at this church, we don't tithe because there's a devourer that we are trying to avoid. Right? We tithe from a place of responsibility. Right? So as members of this church, every month, we give a tenth of our income just from a place of responsibility. Is a way of training ourselves that our resources belong to the Lord. And so we give in that manner. It's also a way of thanking Him. So we give our tithes and then we give our offerings. So I want to invite you to do that right now. I'm going to lead a prayer and then we'll move on. Father, we thank you for your blessings in our lives. Thank you for the blessedness of salvation. You don't count our sins against us. This is the greatest gift any man could hope for. It's the greatest gift any man could receive. You have given us that and we are thankful. Thankful also for your provision in our lives. Thank you because the grace continues to abound towards us without measure. And we do this cheerfully and generously, all to the praise of your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Please leverage the means to give. If you still like to partner with us for deeper, you're more than welcome to do that. After you give your offerings, there's also another bucket you can give to. I think it's labeled special giving. So if you want to give to that, the Lord leads you, please do that. All right, a few more announcements. Triumph 30. Who knows what Triumph 30 is? So Triumph 30 is our interdenominational prayer platform. And we pray on that platform 4 times a day. Okay? But Apostle is leading, our lead pastor is leading the sessions that happen at 1 a.m. our time. It's 6 a.m. West African time, but it's 1 a.m. our time. And as a church, it's expected that all of us participate. Not just because, you know, it's our church and we're doing, it's for your own benefit. Lots of prophecies are going out. God is positioning us as a church corporately and individually for what He's set to do next. Can somebody adjust this light? It's in the eyes of people. So sorry. Please let the team just raise this up. All right? Thank you. What was I saying? Triumph 30. So please, plug in. I know it's inconvenient. It's 1 a.m. I can't do it. No problem. When you wake up in the morning, the first thing, tune in. Just pray. It's going to last about 45 minutes to an hour. Pray. Just tune in. Watch it. Pray. Declare prophecies over your life and watch God transform your life in this period. So we're going for 40 days. We've done the first 5 days. And so next week we go again. And we are strengthened to continue in Jesus' name. Our lead pastor is also a musician. And in a few days, specifically on the 12th of April, he's going to be releasing some new sounds. Let me say something. I'm privileged by proxy to have listened to those songs. And I'm telling you, they will bless you. Enough said. Praise the Lord. Don't forget, Deeper is coming also. And Apostle is going to be here.
So keep praying, keep preparing, keep planning. Apostle is also going to touch some cities. He's going to be in Winnipeg. Yeah, if you don't clap, they are clapping where they are. I see them. He's going to be in Ottawa. He's going to be in Calgary, right? And so just prepare, pray along with us. Come with an open heart and to receive all that God has planned. Amen. All right, we're not going to bring our service to a close without acknowledging some special folks in our midst. If it's your first time worshiping with us, just wave at me wherever you might be. Any first timers in the house? If you're around, come on, Celebration Church, you can welcome them better. Give them a handshake, give them a high five. If you don't mind, please stand to your feet just so we can welcome you properly. Any first timers in the house? Can we welcome them? Say, welcome home. Say it again loud. Say, welcome home. God bless you. Thank you for being a part of our service. We love the fact that you came. You look amazing. You look wonderful. The protocol team members are going around with the gift bags. It's a little token of our appreciation, our way of saying thank you for being a part of our service. We hope to see you again next week and the week after that and the week after that until Jesus comes. And everyone says a loud amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. My only ask is, you can take your seat if you've gotten your gift bag. My only request is, once the service is done, just for about 5 minutes, just come sit right here. Members of the team have the word they would like to give to you. Can we honor and appreciate them one more time? Amen. There's a second group of people we'd like to acknowledge. If it's your second time worshiping with us, we acknowledge the fact that you came back the second time. It's not a small thing to us. So we want to honor you. So right where you are, just wave your hand. You don't have to stand this time. Just wave. Any second timers? I see you. I see you. I see you. God bless you. God bless you. Can we welcome them back? Say, welcome back. Welcome back. It is the pleasure of our lives. It is the honor of our lives that you would worship with us a second time. It means so many things, right? It means, you know, you were blessed the first time you came. It means you enjoyed your service. It means, you know, we're not boring. You had a great time. And you said, you know, I want to experience this again. Thank you for coming back. It means so much to us. And to prove that to you, we have another gift we'd like to give to you. So please don't rush off. Once the service is done, just come sit right here, my extreme right, your extreme left. And the team is going to hand those gifts, just place those gifts in your hands. Can we honor them one more time? And while we're doing that, let's stand as we bring our service to a close. Are you going to use what you have heard today? Are people going to hear this message from your lips? You don't sound confident. Come on, Celebration Church, are you going to use what you have heard today? All right. Glory to God. All right, let's take our benediction. Please repeat after me as loud as you can. Are you ready?
Yes.
Say after me, say,
we serve God by His Spirit.
We boast in Christ Jesus.
We
put no confidence in the flesh. We experience progress and joy in the faith. Reaching
a billion souls
in 10,000 cities. Because we are Celebration Church in Christ, for Christ. Shout glory! God bless you. Have a phenomenal week.
To our esteemed guests, our first timers and our second timers, please do not be in a hurry to leave. We would like to host you to a very short reception. Second timers, extreme right hand side of the hall. Second timers, extreme right hand side of the hall, and first timers.